وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى, today is our fourth lesson on the explanation of the kitab Bulugh al-Maram min Adillat al-Ahkam by Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, Kitab al-Hajj. Today we're going to be doing the famous and long hadith of Jabir, in which he describes the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's, in which he explains the Hajj of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. نعم.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. باب صفة الحج والدخول
في الحج. The author رحمه الله, he chaptered here باب صفة الحج. This chapter is the chapter of description of Hajj rituals and entering Mecca. Two things: the description of Hajj ritual, and the entering of Mecca. The Hajj, it consists of speech and it also consists of actions. It starts with tawaf and then sa'i. And if I mention it, the whole entire Hajj quickly, and the description, and then we go into more details, is the person comes for Umrah. He's doing tamattu. So the person comes, he comes for Umrah, he comes to the house of Allah Azza wa Jalla, he comes, we spoke about the Ihram, he wears his Ihram, he comes to Mecca, and when he comes to Mecca, he does tawaf around the Kaaba 7 times. That's what it starts with. And when he does the tawaf, we'll learn more about the tawaf and how it works. But I'm trying to go fast, inshallah ta'ala, and give you an overview. So he goes around the Kaaba 7 times. And then he goes to Maqam Ibrahim. And he prays 2 rak'ah. In front of Maqam Ibrahim and the Kaaba. So Maqam Ibrahim is here and behind it is the Kaaba. If he can't, because of it being crowded and anything and everything, then he should go a bit further away. There's no problem with it. He prays 2 rak'ah. The first rak'ah he recites, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ, and the second one he reads, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. When he does that, he gets up, he drinks Zamzam water, and it's recommended that he tries to touch the black stone. But if he can't because of it being crowded, no problem. He goes to the Sa'i, Safa wal Marwa. He starts with Safa, because of the ayah, Inna Safa wal Marwa min sha'airillah. Allah started with Safa. So the person starts with Safa, and he goes like that. We'll speak more about that, inshallah ta'ala, soon. Then what the person does is, he shaves his hair, or he shortens his hair, and he's finished his Umrah. Umrah is done. He waits until the 10th of Dhul Hijjah. Sorry, to the 8th of Dhul Hijjah. Yawm al-Tarwiyah, the 8th of Dhul Hijjah, he waits. It's called Yawm al-Tarwiyah. We'll learn, inshallah, soon why it's called Yawm al-Tarwiyah. So what he does is, on the 8th of Dhul Hijjah, he comes to Mina. So it starts from Mina. He comes to Mina, And he prays al-dhuhr, al-asr, al-maghrib, al-isha, and al-fajr. All of those prayers, he prays it in their time. He's not allowed to combine it, but he shortens it and increases in the talbiyah and the adhkar and the dua at that period. Once he has prayed Salatul Fajr and the sun rises, he goes towards Arafah on the 9th. He goes to Arafah and he prays there al-dhuhr wal-asr jam'an. Combines them. The jam' here is jam' and taqsir. Am qasr. He combines the two and he shortens it as well. With one adhan and two iqamas. For two prayers, right? And he remains there ila an taghrub ash-shams. And he stays there until the sun sets. And he increases in the dua and the adhkar and the begging of Allah Azza wa Jalla. When the sun sets, and he has to make sure that the sun sets, he doesn't pray Maghrib. He doesn't pray Maghrib. He does al-ifadat ila Muzdalifah. He goes to Muzdalifah. And he prays Maghrib and al-Isha in al-Muzdalifah. Combines them two. And the jam'u is called jam'u ta'khir. He puts it over there. And the way that he goes to his Muzdalifah is bisakinatin wa waqar. Easy and calm. When he reaches Muzdalifah, he prays Maghrib and he prays Isha. Jam'an wa qasran. Combines them and he shortens it. And he stays there the night. He sleeps, as the Prophet did, alayhi salatu wasalam. There's no ibadah that you busy yourself with. You just pray your witr and you sleep until Salatul Fajr. Salatul Fajr, when you pray it and the sun rises, you go ila Mina. So your rami of Jamarat al-Aqaba, the throwing of the stone. And you only throw the Aqabatul Kubra, which is close to Mecca, and you stone seven times. After you have stoned, and you went to Mina and you stoned, you have come with At-Tahallul Al-Awwal, the first At-Tahallul. If you have a sheep with you, slaughter it. Shave your hair, or shorten it. Then the person goes to Tawaful Ifadah. The person cleans himself, showers, he beautifies himself, and then he goes to Makkah to do Tawaful Ifadah. And if the person hasn't done the Sa'yi that we mentioned, if he didn't do it, he does it here. Then he goes back to Al-Mabitu ila Mina. The person goes back to after Tawaf al-Ifadah, he goes to Mina and he stays there the 11th, the 12th. If he wants to hasten, he can leave after the 12th. But if the 12th night the sun sets on you, you have to stay for the 13th. Then the person goes to Ramyul Jamara. Ramyul Jimar, the three stonings now. Sughra, Wusta, and Aqaba, seven each. And then last but not least, the person then goes back, he's finished his Hajj, but there's one thing still on his neck. When he's about to leave Mecca, and he wants to leave the house of Allah Azza wa Jalla, he does Tawaful Wada', and he makes it the last thing that he does in Mecca. That's a fast, quick summary of Hajj. Now we're going to go in great details, inshallah ta'ala, this famous hadith, more explanation, more understanding, inshallah, تعالى. نعم. This hadith, Al-Imam al-Nawawi, who said, it's good to write this, Al-Imam al-Nawawi said about this hadith in the sharah of Sahih Muslim, because the hadith is in Sahih Muslim. Al-Imam al-Nawawi said, وَهُوَ حَدِيثٌ عَظِيمٌ مُشْتَمِلٌ عَلَى جُمَلٍ مِّنَ الْفَوَائِدِ وَنَفَائِسٍ مِّنْ مُهِمَّاتِ الْقَوَاعِدِ قَالَ الْقَاضِيُ قَدْ تَكَلَّمَ النَّاسُ عَلَى مَا فِيهِ مِنَ الْفِقْهِ وأكثر وصنف فيه أبو بكر بن المنذر جزءا كبيرا وخرج فيه من الفقه 150 نوعا ولو تقصي لزيد على هذا القدر قريب منه. He said, this is a great hadith. Imam al-Nawawi said, this is a great hadith. It contains many beneficial points and the substance of many important principles. And then he brought the statement of Al-Qadi Iyad. He said, Qala Al-Qadi, Qadi said, Qadi Iyad said, the people have spoken about its points of jurisprudence and have mentioned many points. Abu Bakr ibn Munzir has compiled a large volume on this hadith and has derived some 150 points. An additional similar amount could be added to that. No, he said. So this hadith is of great fawaid, great benefit. We won't be able to finish 150 points. If we finish 50 points, it would be very good. This hadith, Al-Imam Muslim narrated it. Bukhari did not narrate it. It's from the hadith that scholars great, they consider to be what? Min afradi Muslim dun al-Bukhari. It is the hadith which Al-Imam Muslim was alone in over Bukhari. So let's mention the story behind this hadith. So we have a bit of understanding and then we go into the hadith inshaAllah ta'ala. Muslim narrated from two of his sheikhs, Abu Bakr ibn Abi Shayba and Ishaq ibn Ibrahim, and Ishaq ibn Rahuya, two of his teachers. He narrated this hadith from two sheikhs, who both of them narrated from Hatim ibn Ismail al-Madani and Ja'far ibn Muhammad and Abihi Qala. Ja'far ibn Muhammad is Ja'far ibn Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Hussein ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib. So this is the Prophet's family. So Ja'far said, I heard this from my father, Ja'far ibn Muhammad. You all know Ja'far? What's his name? What's he called? It's who they call Al-Bakir. The Shia, they call him what? Al-Bakir. He's our Imam. And Ja'far ibn Muhammad, he said, عن أبيه, from his father, دخلنا على علي على جابر ibn Abdullah. So Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Hussein, he said, رضي الله تعالى عنه, he said, I entered upon Ali. Jabir. I came to Jabir. فسأل عن القوم. Jabir asked about the people who were there. Why did he ask about the people who were there? Because Jabir became blind at this time. He couldn't see no one. Jabir was blind. So he couldn't see anyone. So he asked, who's in the room? Who's with me? So everyone introduced themselves. حَتَّى انْتَهَى إِلَيَّ, until it came to me. When it came to me, Muhammad ibn Ali ibn al-Husayn, he said, when it came to me, فَأَهْوَى بِيَدِهِ إِلَىٰ رَأْسِي. Jabir placed his hand on my head, like that. فَنَزْعَى, and then he unbuttoned زِرِّ الْأَعْلَى, my top button, he opened it with his hand. ثُمَّ نَزْعَى, and then he opened زِرِّ الْأَسْفَلَ, and he opened the button after that one. ثُمَّ وَضَعَ كَفَّهُ, then he placed his palm بَيْنَ ثَدْيَى, he placed it on my chest. وَأَنَا يَوْمَئِذٍ, that day I was غُلَامٌ شَابٌ, I was a young boy. I wasn't old, I was young. I was a youth. فَقَالَ, he said to me, مَرْحَبًا بِكَ يَا إِبْنَ أَخِي, welcome my nephew. سَلْ عَمَّا شِئْتَ, ask what you want. What we take from this is how important it is to give attention to the youths and the youngsters. And the way he did it was in a very comfortable way, for and a welcoming way. First he spoke to him, first he touched him. He touched him from the head, and then he put his hand on his chest. And Jabir is a highly respected man, and he's young. And not only that, he made dua for, he made him welcome. He said, marhaban, welcome. And then the third thing he said to him was, ask whatever you want. This benefits us, the way that the alim or student of knowledge should be. Like welcoming, approachable. People, when they come to you, you comfort them. That's important. Especially the youths who are the future of this ummah. The youths are the future of the ummah. They need that. They shouldn't be kicked out, and pushed away and ignored. And also, it shows us that the Prophet's family, they used to seek knowledge. And that the concept of lineage and your background, it doesn't necessarily take you to Jannah. Are we all together? If it's not coupled with Iman. Abu Lahab was what? It was the Prophet's uncle. It was the Prophet's uncle. Will that take him to Jannah? No, it won't take him to Jannah. The hadith says, وَمَنْ بَطَأَ بِي عَمَلُهُ لَمْ يُسْرِعْ بِهِ نَسَبُهُ. Anyone whose lineage delays him. You didn't come with righteous actions. Your lineage and where you're from and your background and your country will not push you forward. So Jabir radiallahu anhu did that. فَسَأَلْتُهُ, I asked him. وَهُوَ أَعْمَى, you see he was blind. وَحَضَرَ وَقْتُ الصَّلَاةِ, the salah time came in when I wanted to ask. And so we went to the prayer. And we prayed. And then he said, I asked him. He put on his mantle, which was too loose for him, or too short for him. And فَصَلَّى بِنَا, he led the salah, Jabir. فَقُلْتُ, I then said to him, when we prayed and we came back again, I said, أَخْبِرْنِي عَنْ حَجَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Tell me about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's hajj. فَقَالَ بِيَدِي فَعَقَدَ تِسْعًا. He did with his hand to show me nine. He showed me nine. فَقَالَ, he then said, and then the hadith starts. This hadith is very long and is the most detailed hadith, but there are things that Jabir missed out. But there is no hadith better than it. And Muslim brought it in its length. Muslim what? Brought it in its length. The way I want to go through it, inshallah ta'ala, is before I comment on the hadith, let's do some things, inshallah ta'ala. Let's first of all study the concept of Hajj in a bit more details than the way I just did it. And then we talk about what the Prophet did, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Write this down, inshallah ta'ala. Hajj is a ibadah, and it's one of the five pillars of Islam. Lahu arkanun, it has pillars. Wa wajibat, it has obligatory acts. Wa sunan, and it has sunnah acts. So pay attention. Hajj has essential components. It also has essential pillars. It also has obligatory acts. And it also has sunan. What's the difference between these three? The general difference between these three is a rukun, a pillar, if you don't come with it, your act is null and void. It's finished. Are we all together? You have to bring it back. That's what a rukun means. Arkan, it means if you don't come with this, it's gone, null and void. Wajib is what? Wajib is if you don't come with it, you're a sinner. But you don't have to necessarily come with that act, something else can take its place, position. You might have to pay an expiation or etc. Are we all together? And the third one is sunan. Sunan is that which is voluntary. Sunnah. It's not obligatory, you don't have to do it. So let's mention the sunanul hajj. The things that are sunan. Once we finish that, we will mention the wajibat, and then we mention the arkan. What does hajj start with? It starts with the ihram, right? The ihram is the where it all starts from, right? So let's start with the ihram. There are 13 things. No, I've written seven. Seven things that are sunnah for hajj, for ihram. The ihram, sunan. Number one, it's a sunnah for your ihram. It is al-ghuslu inda al-ihram. It is to make complete washing. You have to do complete washing. And that is based on the hadith of Aisha that we mentioned previously. كُنْتُ أُطَيِّبُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لِإِحْرَامِهِ حِينَ يُحْرِمُ وَلِحِلِّهِ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَطُوفَ بِالْبَيْتِ. We took that hadith, right? Where she said, I would place perfume on the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم when he would go for his ihram. She would place it on his body. We've spoken about that. Oh, that's sorry, that's the, what did it, sorry. Did I mention perfume? I mentioned the evidence for perfume, sorry. The evidence is that the Prophet ﷺ would shower, is not that evidence. The evidence is the hadith of Zayd ibn Thabit. أنه رأى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم تجرد لإلاله واغتسل. That the Messenger took his clothes off and he showered. That's the evidence to shower or to completely clean yourself. And the person does this to get rid of the smell. Number two is الطيب في بدنه قبل الإحرام. Before you put your ihram on, what do? You put perfume on your body. And the evidence for that is the hadith I just mentioned for Aisha. كنت أطيب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الإحرام حين يحرم ولحلي قبل أن يطوف بالبيت. That she said, I would place on the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم perfume before he would put his ihram on. The third sunnah for the ihram is أن يحرم في إزار ورداء أبيضين. To wear a white waist wrapper and a outer garment. So the top and the bottom that you're wearing, two garments at the bottom one and the upper one, both of them to be white. It's recommended. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, انطلق النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من المدينة بعدما ترجل ودهن ولبس إزاره ورداءه هو وأصحابه. That hadith is the evidence to show to wear two izars. Abdullah ibn Abbas, and he said, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he left Medina after he combed his hair and after he placed perfume on himself. وَلَبِسَ, and he wore izarahu, he wore the lower garment, the waist wrapper, and rida'a, which is the top, the outer garment. هو أصحابه. He did it and his companions did it. As for it being white, is based on the hadith of Abbas also, where the Prophet said, إِلْبِسُوا wear مِنْ ثِيَابِكُمُ الْبَيَاضَ, wear from your clothes white. فَإِنَّهَا مِنْ خَيْرِ ثِيَابِكُمْ, because it's the best of your clothes. وَكَفِّنُوا فِيهَا مَوْتَاكُمْ, and shroud white on your dead. So this hadith shows that it's recommended. Number four, الصلاة في وادي العقيق لمن مر به. Number four is to pray in the valley of Al-Aqiq. To pray in where? In the valley of Al-Aqiq. This is based on the hadith that we took before. Remember hadith Umar رضي الله تعالى عنه, where the Prophet said, أتاني الليلة آت من ربي, tonight a visitor from my Lord came to me. And he said to me, صَلِّ فِي هَذَا, pray here, الْوَادِ الْمُبَارَكَةِ, pray in this blessed valley, وَقُلْ, and say, عُمْرَةٌ فِي حَجَّةٍ, and say, عُمْرَةٌ with Hajj. Number five, رَفْعُ الصَّوْتِ بِالتَّلْبِيَةِ, to raise your voice whilst repeating the talbiyah. We took the hadith of As-Sa'ib ibn Khalad ibn Sa'ib, right? Was it As-Sa'ib ibn Khalad or Khalad ibn Sa'ib? Khalad ibn Sa'ib. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, أتاني جبريل فأمرني أن آمر أصحابي. Jibreel came to me and he commanded me and he told me to tell my companions, أن يرفعوا أصواتهم, for them to raise their voices, بالإهلال أو التلبية, that they raise their voices. Jibreel came and told me that they raise their voices with the intention that they make and the talbiyah. So the Sahabas, they used to do it. And after him, salawatullahi wasalamun alayhi, they would raise their voices. The narrator said, حَتَّى تُبَحُّ أَصْوَاتُهُمْ, the Sahabas would raise their voices so loud and so high until they would lose their voices. The way they would shout. The Sahaba to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the talbiyah for the person to say is labbaik Allahumma labbaik. Labbaik la sharika laka labbaik. Innal hamda wal ni'mata laka wal mulk. La sharika lak. That's the sunnah. And the person says it loud, as we mentioned. And the person carries on this hatta al-jamarat al-kubra. Talbiyah keeps going until the person does what? Jamarat al-kubra. Based on the hadith of Ibn Abbas, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أردف الفضل فأخبر الفضل أنه لم يزل يلبي حتى رمى الجمرة. The messenger said to Fadl ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Abbas's brother, he said to him, I have been consistent in doing my talbiya until I stoned the jamara, min jamara tul aqaba. Number 6, التحميد والتسبيح والتكبير قبل الإهلال. Number 6 is repeating the phrases Alhamdulillah and Subhanallah and Allahu Akbar. You repeat this before saying the talbiyah. قبل الإهلال. Based on the hadith of Anas ibn Malik, قال صلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ونحن معه بالمدينة الظهر أربعا والعصر بذي الحليفة ركعتين ثم بات بها حتى أصبح ثم ركب حتى استوت به على البيداء حمد الله وسبح وكبر ثم أهل بحج وعمرة. This hadith says, Anas ibn Malik's hadith, that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he prayed the noon prayer, 4 units, while we were in Medina. And he prayed the afternoon prayer, 2 units in the Al-Hulayfa. Then he spent the night there until the morning. Then he rode until he was upon Al-Bayda, praising Allah, exalting his perfection, exalting him in his greatness, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he made the talbiyah for Hajj al-Umrah. So he did it before he done. And the 7th is Al-Ihlal Mustaqbil Al-Qibla. To say the talbiyah whilst facing the Qibla. To say the talbiyah whilst facing the Qibla. And this is based on the hadith of Nafi'. قال كان ابن عمر إذا صلى بالغداة بذي الحليفة أمر براحلته فرحلت ثم ركب فإذا استوت به استقبل القبلة قائما ثم يلبي وزعم أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فعل ذلك. Nafi' said, when ابن عمر would pray the morning prayer at Dhul Hulayfa, he would get his mount ready and then get on it. He used to face the Qibla, saying the Talbiyah as he sat on his mount, setting off to Mecca. He said that the Messenger of Allah also did that which I am doing right now. Those 7 are the Sunnah of Al-Ihram. The Sunnah of Ihram. Now we're going to go into the Sunnah of facing Mecca, entering Mecca. These 7 sunan are related to entering Mecca. And they are, inshallah ta'ala, 4 sunan. In total, how much is it going to be? With the 7 that we mentioned, how much is it going to be? Sorry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6, sorry. 6 onto the 7. Is how much? 13. So it's going to be 13 altogether so far. So add these 6. These are the 6 of the Sunnah of Dukhuli Makkah. These 6 are the Sunnah related to entering Makkah. Number 1 is Al-Mabitu Bidi Tuwa. It is spending the night at the Tuwa. And number 2, والاغتسال لدخول مكة, to perform ghusl before you enter Mecca. ودخولها نهارا, and entering it at daytime. And entering Mecca at daytime, not nighttime, daytime. Those are the three. Al-Mabitu bi dhi Tuwa, wal-Iqtisalu lidukhuli Makkati, wal-Dukhulu Hanharan. Those three, the evidence for it is, كان ابن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنهما إذا دخل أدنى الحرم أمسك عن التلبية ثم يبيت بذي طوى ثم يبيت بذي طوى ثم يصلي بالصبح ويغتسل ويحدث أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يفعل ذلك. عبد الله بن عمر, if he entered Mecca or he came close to Mecca, he would hold from the talbiyah, he won't say the talbiyah, and he would stay in the Tuwa, he will remain there for that night. ثم يصلي به الصبح, and he will pray الصبح, the Fajr, in the Tuwa. ويغتسل, and he would shower. ويحدث, and then he would say to the people that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم is the one who used to do this. He said the Prophet is the one who did this. Number 11, am I the fourth? Are we all together, Number four. دخول مكة من ثنية العليا. Entering Mecca through the higher ravine, ثنية العليا, to enter it from there. And that is based on the hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the messenger was one, يدخل من, he would enter from من الثنية العليا ويخرج من ثنية السفلى. He would enter it from the higher ravine, the Prophet, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the higher passage, and he would come out from the lower passage. Then number 12, I'm a 5, if you're counting the sunan al-dukhuli Mecca. 5, أن يقدم رجله اليمنى عند الدخول إلى المسجد ويقول, that the person, he enters the mosque, the masjid, the Kaaba, he enters with his right leg. وَيَقُولُ, he says, اللهم, he says, أعوذ بالله, I seek refuge in Allah, العظيم, the great Lord, وبوجهه الكريم. The person says, أعوذ بالله, I seek refuge in Allah, the great, by his noble face, وسلطانه القديم, and his ancient authority, من الشيطان الرجيم, from the accursed Satan. بسم الله, in the name of Allah. اللهم, oh Allah, صل على محمد, send and shower Muhammad with blessings and peace. اللهم افتح لي, oh Allah, open for me أبواب رحمتك, the doors of your mercy. The person says that. And number 13, which is the sixth, فإذا رأى البيت رفع يديه إن شاء. And if the person sees the house, he raises his hands and he makes dua, because this was transmitted from Abdullah ibn Abbas. He used to say, Allahumma anta as-salamu wa minka as-salamu fahayyina rabbana bis-salami. And it sound that is being narrated from him, that Abdullah ibn Abbas would say that, oh Allah, you are the source of peace. And, oh Allah, you are the source of peace. And confirm, Allah, you are the source of peace. And peace comes from you. فَحَيِّنَا رَبَّنَا بِالسَّلَامِ. Oh Allah, allow us to live in peace. And this is sound. It's correctly transmitted from him. Now we're going to go into the Sunan al-Tawaf. The person, the sunnah of going around the Kaaba, circumambulating around the Kaaba. The first is al-idhiba', and al-idhiba' means that the person, he shows his right arm. So he places it under his armpits, the ihram, and he shows his right arm. And then he takes the other side and he throws it on top of his left shoulder. That is what it's called. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith, anna nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tawafa, the Prophet, he circumambulated around the Kaaba muttabi'an, whilst his right hand arm can be seen. The second is istilamu hajar al-aswadi, the person touches the black stone. Whilst he's going around the Kaaba, he tries to touch the black stone. When it comes to touching the black stone, there are many ways. I'll expand on that later, inshallah ta'ala. Li hadith ibn Umarin, based, so you touch the Kaaba, so you touch the black stone. This is based on the hadith ibn Umar. He said, Ra'aytu Rasulallah, I saw the Messenger of Allah, yaqdumu Makkata, coming to Mecca, إِذَا اسْتَلَمَ الرُّكْنَ الْأَسْوَدَ أَوَّلَ مَا يَطُوفُ يَخُبُّ ثَلَاثَةَ أَطْوَافٍ مِنَ السَّبْعِ. Abdullah ibn Umar, he said, I saw the Messenger of Allah upon arriving in Mecca, touching and kissing the black stone. While beginning circumambulation, he walked quickly in the first three of the seven circumambulation, which we're going to come to now. Number three is تَقْبِيلُ الْحَجَرِ, to kiss the black stone. So the second was to touch it. Like in the third one is to kiss it. Umar radiallahu anhu, what did he say to the black stone when he came to it? He said to him, the black stone, لَوْلَا أَنِّي رَأَيْتُ, if I wasn't to see رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, the Messenger of Allah, قَبَّلَكَ مَا قَبَّلْتُكَ, I would never have kissed you. If I didn't see the Prophet kiss you, I would not have kissed you. The fourth, etiquettes and manners and sunnah when circumambulating around the Kaaba is as-sujudu alayhi, to prostrate on the black stone. And this is based on the hadith of Umar. He said, Ra'aytu Umar ibn al-Khattabi qabbala al-hajara wa sajada alayhi. I saw Abdullah ibn Umar, and he said, I saw Umar kiss the black stone and put his forehead on the stone. Thumma aada faqabbala wa sajada alayhi. And then he kissed it again, and then he put his forehead on it. Thumma qala, and then he said, Hakada ra'aytu Rasulallah. I saw the Prophet do that. Five. التكبير عند الركن. The person, he says the takbir upon passing the corner. You say Allahu Akbar. That's the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. لحديث ابن عباس. طاف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بالبيت على بعيره كلما أتى الركن أشار إليه بشيء كان عنده وكبر. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, whenever he would go around the Kaaba, he would, when he circumambulated around the Kaaba, whenever he came to that side, ashara ilayhi, he would point towards it with either an object or his hand. Like in some people, you see they do two hands. They use both their hands. That's not from the sunnah, or shaking it like this. You see people do that. All of that is not from the sunnah. Naam. Number six, right? الرمل في الأشواط الثلاثة الأولى من الطواف الأول. The person, he jogs in the first three of the tawaf. He jogs. And inshallah ta'ala, we will mention the wisdom of the jogging. When we come to it, inshallah ta'ala, why does that sunnah was prescribed to jog around the Kaaba. The first three, you jog. This is based on the hadith of Umar, أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا طاف بالبيت الطواف الأول رمل ثلاثة ومشى أربعة من الحجر إلى الحجر. So the first three, he will jog, and the next four, he would walk normally, صلى الله عليه وسلم. The jogging is from one, you count it, when you start, where do you start from? You start from the black stone, right? You go round, that's one, to the black stone again. And then again round, to the black stone again, second. And then third, to the black stone, then you finished your three. Circumambulation of the tawaf, in which you would jog. The seventh is istilamu al-rukn al-yamani, is to touch. It is to what? To touch the Yemeni corner. Which is the, it's not opposite, but it's on the other side of the Kaaba, to touch it. This is based on the hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar. He said, Lam ara an-nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wasallam yastalimu min al-bayt illa al-ruknayn al-yamaniyayn. I only saw the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam touch the two sides of the Kaaba that face towards Yemen. And that's the black stone and the other side. The other two, which are known as the Rukn al-Shamaniyayn, they are not touched. Are we all together? And Imam al-Shafi'i, as Hafidh ibn Hajar mentioned in Fath al-Bari, that Imam al-Shafi'i, he said, we did not leave touching the other two sides of the Kaaba hajran lil bayti, because we want to boycott the house of Allah, or that we want to boycott the Kaaba. ولكننا نتبع السنة فعلا وتركها. لكن الإمام الشافعي, he said, the reason why we don't touch the other two sides of the Kaaba is because we follow the Messenger in what he does, and we follow the Messenger in what he leaves. Are we all together? So we do what he did, and we leave off what he left off. It's very important that you understand that. We follow the Messenger, what he does. We also follow him in what? What he left. We have to follow him in that. The eighth is أن يدعو بين الركنين بهذه الدعوة. In between the two sides of the Yemeni corner, in between them, you make the dua, ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. Number 9, right? The person says, صَلَاتُ رَكْعَتَيْنِ بَعْدَ الطَّوَافِ خَلْفَ الْمَقَامِ. The person, he prays after completing the circumambulation, you perform a 2 rak'ah prayer behind the house of Ibrahim. 2 rak'ah. You pray. And the evidence for this is the hadith of Umar. قَدِمَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فطاف بالبيت سبعا ثم صلى خلف المقام ركعتين وطاف بين الصفا والمروة. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he done tawaf around the Kaaba 7 times, and then he prayed behind the Maqam Ibrahim. 2 rak'ah. What is it that he reads? That brings us to the next point, which is 10, right? Point number 10 is أن يقرأ عند المقام قبل الصلاة. You read next to the maqam before you go into the salah. You say واتخذوا من مقام إبراهيم مصلى. Like, again, we're going to talk about the khilaf or the discussion of this issue. Did the Messenger do it when he said that? Because the Prophet did say that. We're going to see it in the hadith of Jabir. The Messenger did say واتخذوا من مقام إبراهيم مصلى when he came to the maqam. Like, did he do this من باب التعليم? He was trying to teach the companions. وَاتَّخِذُ مِن مَقَامِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ مُصَلَّى. Take from this place a musalla. Or was this something that it is part of the ritual? There's a khilaf amongst the scholars. We will talk about that later, inshallah ta'ala. So what does the person recite? In the first rak'ah he recites قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. And the second rak'ah he reads قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَد. The 11th is إِلْتِزَامُ مَا بَيْنَ الرُّكْنِ وَالْبَابِ. Is to supplicate. Between the black stone corner and the door of the Kaaba, by pulling with one's chest and face and forearms against the Kaaba. And this is taken from the hadith of Jabir that is going to come to us, inshallah ta'ala. 11, right? What number are we on now? 12. 12 is شرب من ماء زمزم وغسل الرأس به. To drink them Zamzam water. And also to what? Pour that water on your head. That's all in the hadith of Jabir. So you drink it, and you take some of the water, and you place it over yourself. The scholars have discussed Zamzam water. Are you allowed to shower with it? Or is it prohibited? Fuqaha talk about it. Some of the fuqaha, they say it's not allowed for 2 reasons. Number one, It's a blessed water. And the second reason they say is because the messenger referred to the Zamzam water as food. Hadith of Abi Dharrin, when the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, Ma'u Zamzam, the water of Zamzam is tu'mun, it's food. Because Abi Dharr, he told the Prophet that he came to Mecca and he had no food to eat. And he said, I stayed in Mecca and I ate nothing and I only lived on Zamzam water and it used to fill me up. Until my stomach, I started to get folds on my stomach, Abi Dharr said. And then the messenger said to him that the Zamzam water is a what? It's food. So they said, you can't play around with food. Are we all together? And that's another discussion. Now we're going to go into the sunnah related to the circuits of a sa'i. Going in between Safa wal Marwa. The sunnah related to that. استلام الركن على النحو السابق. Touching the corner as mentioned earlier. When you finish your drinking Zamzam water, it's a sunnah to go where? And to go and touch the black stone, to touch the corner, the rukun, the right, the other side. It's recommended. No, the corner. The second is qira'ah, to recite إِنَّ الصَّفَى وَالْمَرْوَةَ مِنْ شَعَائِرِ اللَّهِ فَمَنْ حَجَّ الْبَيْتَ أَوْ اِعْتَمَرَ فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِ أَنْ يَطَّوَّفَ بِهِمَا وَمَنْ تَطَوَّعَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ شَاكِرٌ عَلِيمٌ وَمَنْ تَطَوَّعَ خَيْرًا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ شَاكِرٌ عَلِيمٌ. Then the person says, إِبْدَأْ بِمَا بَدَأَ اللَّهُ بِهِ. To recite that verse. The ayah is ayah 158 in Surah Al-Baqarah. The ayah translates as, verily, As-Safa and Al-Marwa, they are two hillock of mountains in Mecca, are of the symbols of Allah. So it is not a sin on him who performs Hajj and Umrah of the house to perform the going between them, meaning Safa and Marwa. Whoever does good deeds, then verily Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will reward them. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is all aware of what we do. The third is istiqbalul qiblati wa huwa ala safa. When the person goes on the mountain safa, so you make inna safa wal marwa min sha'a'ilillah, you say that, and then you go on the mountain. And then when you go on the mountain, you recite, or you say, facing the Qibla. You say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar 3 times. You say it 3 times, and then you say, La ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah, lahul mulk, wa lahul hamd, wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. La ilaha illallah wahda, anjaza wa'da, ونصر عبده وهزم الأحزاب وحده. Then the person makes the dua that they wish. The person does that. How many times do you make this dua and you face the Qibla and you do all of this? First 3. Or you say it 3 times. Number 4, السعي بين العالمين الأخضرين سعيا شديدا. You jog between the green lights that have now been placed there. And we'll talk about what's the significance of those 2 green lights. When you come to that green light, بين الصفا والمروة, you're going to see it. You kind of jog a bit fast. Okay? And we'll all these jogging and run, we'll talk about who is it for and who is it not for. Who can do it and who can't. First, we want to go over it. And then we're going to go in great details. 4, 5 is أن يفعل على المروة ما فعله على الصفا. That the person does what they did in the Safa, they do it in Marwa. They do the same thing, nothing new. At this point, the person, he has finished his what? He's finished? his umrah. He's finished his umrah, right? Because he's doing tamattu', so you finished your umrah. What do you now do? You shave your hair. If you have a lot of time before Hajj starts, if you don't have much time, then shorten it. So you take off your ihram, you go into Mecca, you do what you want, you can have relationship with your family, there's nothing. Like in the one who's doing Qiran, no, he's still in state of ihram. The one who's doing tamattu' like in, no. He's not in that state of ihram. He just waits for the 8th of Dhul Hijjah, Yawm al-Tarwiyah. Sits around for that day to arrive. That day when it arrives, what did we say he does? He goes where? He goes to Mina. He goes Mina. Okay, so now we're going to talk about the etiquette of and the sunnah related to Mina. We're going to go into that inshallah ta'ala, the sunnah related to Mina. And it's only one. It's four inshallah ta'ala. Number one is al-ihram bil-hajj yawm at-tarwiyah min manzilihi. You don't have to go to no miqat. You don't have to go outside Mecca. You don't have to. On the day of tarwiyah, in your hotel, everything, you just wear it. You wear your ihram, you shower, you everything. And then you go. Are we all together? The reason why it was called yawm at-tarwiyah, it was because before, the people before they went to from outside Mecca and they went to Mina and they're going to go to Muzdalifah and they're going to go Arafah, they don't have water. There is no water. So the people used to do tarwiyah from Mecca, meaning they would give water to their riding beasts. They would get waters packed for themselves to get ready to go. That's why it was called Yawm al-Tarwiyah. Rather, all of the days of Hajj, they have names. Write this down. All of the days of Hajj has names. The 8th day is called Yawm al-Tarwiyah. The 8th day is called Yawm al-Tarwiyah. The 9th day is called Yawm Arafah. The day of Arafah. The 10th day is called Yawm al-Nahr. The 11th day is called Yawm al-Quri. Ama Yawm al-Qur. Qur'in. Ama Quriyun, some scholars say, said. We'll talk about that inshallah ta'ala. The 12th day is called Yawm al-Nafarin. And it's al-Nafar al-Awwal. On the 12th day. And the 13th day is Yawm al-Nafar al-Thani. Those are the days of Hajj. Each day has a name. We'll talk about that in more details inshallah ta'ala. So, the second sunnah related to going to Mina is Salatul Dhuhri, Wal Asri, Wal Maghribi, Wal Isha'i. All of them are prayed in where? Bi Mina. They prayed in Mina. And they prayed all of them Yawm al-Tarwiyah on the 8th day. And the person that night, he stays in Mina, he sleeps in Mina. Until he prays what? What did we say before? In Mina, you come and you pray Asr. And you, Dhuhr. And then you pray Asr. And then you what? Maghrib. And then you pray? You pray Salatul Fajr. When you pray Salatul Fajr and the sun rises, the person, what does he do? The next point now, it's the third point. The third manners is Salatul Dhuhri wal Asri jam'an wa qasran in Namira. Is Namira part of Arafah or not? We'll talk about that. Is Namira part of Arafah or not? We're going to talk about that soon, inshallah ta'ala. But is everybody with me so far? Am I making sense? Let's go back to the sunnah related to Mina. Number one, what did I say the sunnah related to Mina is? Al-ihramu bil-hajj yawm tarwiyati min manzilihi. The person, he wears his clothing, everything from his own house. From where? From his house. The second sunnah related to Mina, going to Mina, is what? You pray Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, all in what? All in Mina, on the 8th, you sleep that night. Yeah? You sleep that night. وَالْمَبِيتُ بِهَا حَتَّى يُصَلِّيَ الْفَجْرَ until you pray Fajr. When you pray Fajr, وَتَطْلُعُ الشَّمْسُ the sun rises. When the sun rises, you leave. As soon as you see the sunrise, you leave now. You prayed Fajr, you stay there until sun rises. When sun rises, the fourth point, or the third point, which is what? Salatul Dhuhri wal Asri jam'an wa qasran bi namira on the day of Arafah. You pray Dhuhr and Asr in Namira. Qas jam'an, you combine and you what? And you also shorten. Question, is Namira from one of the rituals of Hajj or is it not? Or was it something that the messenger did because he got tired and he was fatigued and he just wanted to relax in Namira? Or is Namira a place that is part of Hajj and you have to go and etc.? We'll speak about that in details, inshallah ta'ala. The fourth point is أَلَّا يَنْفِرَ مِنْ عَرَفَةَ قَبْلَ غُرُوبِ الشَّمْسِ. The person should not leave Arafah until the sun sets. Arafah, two things are connected to Arafah. Brothers, are you with me? Two things are connected to Arafah. Being there and remaining there. If a person goes to Arafah, okay? He goes to Arafah. And when he goes to Arafah, he leaves it straight away before the sun sets. Does he have Hajj? So my question is that he goes to Arafah and then he leaves Arafah before the sun sets. Does he have Hajj? Yeah? He has Hajj. Why? Because he went Arafah. But there's a blood on him that he has to sacrifice. Because he didn't stay for what? Until sunset. He didn't stay. That again, we're going to talk about that in more details and the aqwal of the ulama in more details, inshallah ta'ala. Now we're going to go into the arkanul Hajj. The arkan of what? Of Hajj. The pillars of Hajj. The pillars of Hajj is, again, what did we say pillar? If these things are not found, what did we say? If these things are not found, there is a what? There's no Hajj for you, sorry. Number one is a niyyah. You have to have an intention. Because of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. And also, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. Number two is al-wuqufu bi'arafah. The second pillar is that the person stands in Arafah. That the person, he stands in Arafah. Number three is al-mabitu bi-muzdalifa hatta matla'i al-fajri wa salati al-fajri. The third one is to remain in Muzdalifah, spend the night at Muzdalifah until dawn and praying the dawn prayer there. Number four, Tawaful Ifadah. All of these masail, we're going to go in great details. Are they a rukun? Is there khilaf in these issues? First of all, have a tasawwur, and then we're going to take some points out. And number four is tawaful ifadah. Tawaful ifadah, which we mentioned, the person does. This is the fourth one. Because of the ayah, Allah says, وَلِيَطَّوَّفُوا بِالْبَيْتِ الْعَتِيقِ. And number five is السَّعْيُ بَيْنَ الصَّفَى وَالْمَرْوَةِ. Doing a sa'i between Safa and what? And Marwa. Now we're going to go into the wajibatul hajj, the obligatory things for hajj, the obligatory acts of hajj. Number one is al-ihramu min al-miqat, that the person, they get into the ihram from the miqat. And what does it mean, ihram from the miqat? It means that you change your clothes and you leave your previous clothes off, you take that off, and you wear the ihram clothes, and then you make the intention by saying labbaik allahumma umratan, or you say labbaik allahumma hajjatan umrah if it's qiran. Are we all together? The second is al-mabitu bi mina fi layali tashriq, that the person, the days of tashriq, he stays in Mina, the nights of tashriq. And we'll talk about what those nights of tashriq are. We'll talk about which nights those are. I already mentioned it, but we'll go in more details later, inshallah. Number three is ramyul jimari murattaban, throwing the stones and the pebbles in the proper order. So for example, the day of Nahar, the day of the slaughter, he does the jamarat for which one? Al-Aqaba, right? Seven. And the 3 days, what does he do it in? The 11th and 12th and the 13th, what does he do? He throws the other three again. So he does, as we mentioned before, he starts with the Sughra, and then the Wusta, and then the Kubra. He does those three. What is the amount of pebbles that the person throws? Big stones, rocks, your shoes, all of those, it really takes place. You see some people, when they finish their pebbles, they take off their shoes and they start throwing it, not knowing that the shoes are not going to come back for you. It's going to fall into somewhere. How are you going to do with the rest? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to the companions, بِأَمْثَالِ هَؤُلَاءِ, small pebbles he picked up. And the Prophet said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like these small pebbles. وَإِيَّاكُمَ الْغُلُوَّ فِي الدِّينِ, stay away from extremism in your religion. فَإِنَّمَا هَلَكَ مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ بِالْغُلُوَّ فِي الدِّينِ, stay away from extreme. For verily, those who came before you were destroyed by going overboard in their religion. So this hadith teaches us that غلو is not only i'tiqad, belief. Going extreme is not only a belief. A person can also go extreme in what? In actions. You can be an extremist in your actions as well. But what we have to understand is the definition of the word ghulu and extreme is two things. You have to understand this all the time. The word ghulu, it can be ifrat or tafrit, exaggeration or negligence. Some people only think, when they think of the word extreme, they only think of what? The ones who exaggerate. But they don't forget the negligent one is also an extremist in the Sharia. The one who says, I only pray 2 salahs a day, in the Quran and the Sunnah, he's an extremist. Are we all together? So it's not just one side. And what's the evidence for that? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said in the ayah, Ya ahl al-kitab la taghlu, the people of the scripture, don't go overboard in your what? Don't go overboard in your religion. Question, who are the people of the book? The Christians and the Jews, right? And then right after that, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, who did he talk about? Allah says, innama al-masihu Isa ibn Maryam. Isa ibn Maryam is a messenger from Allah. So stop here. You have the Christians and you have the Jews, and you have Isa ibn Maryam being spoken about here, sah? What did the Jews do to Isa ibn Maryam? What did they say about him? They went extreme in negligence. They neglected him. They gave no weight to Isa. Nothing, to them, he's nothing. So they were, Ya ahl al-kitab la taghlu. Allah said, don't come with ghulu, O Jews. But the Jews, ghulu was what? Negligence towards Isa ibn Maryam. And the Christians, their extreme towards Isa was what? Exaggeration. They worshipped him. Are we all together? So ghulu, the word extreme in the Quran and the Sunnah, both are extreme. Extreme is anything that's not the middle path. As Allah said, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. And what is the one, what is, who determines what is extreme and what is an extreme? Who determines it? Our uqul, our way of thinking? No. The nususul wahiyyin, the kitab and the sunnah are the ones that determine what is extreme or what isn't. Are we all together? The Quran and the sunnah is what determines it. Some people, they might consider, for instance, that it's ghulu to have your thobe above your ankles. That's an extreme thing for them. You're an extreme. You're ghulu. Like in that's ghulu fi dhihnika, in your brain. Are we all together? Amma fi nusus al-wahyayn, it's obligatory for the man to have his garment above his what? Above his ankles. Another person may see extreme for a woman to wear a niqab. He might see that as ghulu, ghulu. What are you doing? Why are you doing this to yourself? But the Quran and the Sunnah considers that to be what? Either wajib or a sunnah. Either that's not. Are we all together, brothers? The Quran and the Sunnah is what determines what's extreme or not. Not our uqul and the way we think. So the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَإِيَّاكُمْ وَالْغُلُوَ فِي الدِّينِ فَإِنَّمَا هَلَكَ مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ بِالْغُلُوِ فِي الدِّينِ. Now, I want to go into what are the conditions of tawaf, shart, shurut, just conditions I need to mention. What are the conditions for the tawaf? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, "At-tawafu hawla al-bayti mithlu salati." The tawaf around the Kaaba is like what? It's like salah. Illa annakum tatakallamuna fihi, faman takallama fihi fala yatakallam illa bi khairin. The only difference is that in the tawaf you can talk, but the Prophet said if you're going to talk in the tawaf, don't speak except that which is good. But it's like salah. In anything else other than this is salah. So what is the conditions of the salah? The first condition is taharatu min al-hadathaini. Number one. The one who's doing tawaf around the Kaaba has to have what? He has to have tahara from the two impurities. The two impurities, major and minor. He has to have purity from those two. Major and what? And minor. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he say to Aisha when Hajj came? Her menses happened to Aisha. So the messenger said to her, "If Ali ma yaf'alu al-Hajj, Aisha, do whatever the people of Hajj do. غَيْرَ أَلَّا تَطُوفِي بِالْبَيْتِ حَتَّى تَغْتَسِلِي." But don't go around the Kaaba 7 times. Don't go around it. Don't circumambulate around the Kaaba until you clean yourself and you purify yourself. Are we all together? And then tawaf around the Kaaba, it requires definitely major impurity, has to be clean from it. What about minor? Can you have minor impurity? If you hold the opinion that it's like the salah and that's what it is, then definitely you have to hold the opinion that it's what? Major and minor impurity, you have to clean yourself from it. If not, we'll come to that discussion later, inshallah ta'ala. Number two, satrul awra. The person has to conceal his awra. Didn't Allah not say, "Ya bani Adam, khudu zinatakum 'inda kulli masjidin"? The children of Adam, take your beauty, meaning take your clothings, 'inda kulli masjidin, 'inda kulli salatin, for every prayer. Take your clothings with you for every prayer. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the day of Hajjat al-Wada', the day of slaughter, the messenger said, "Alla yahujj ba'd al-'am," after this year, no one should do Hajj who is a mushrik. A pagan and a polytheist cannot do Hajj from this year, this time onwards. "Wa la yatufu bil bayt 'uryanun," and a person who is naked cannot do tawaf around the Kaaba. A naked person cannot circumambulate around the Kaaba. This is what the Quraysh used to do. They used to take off all of their clothing, men and women. And they would go around the Kaaba 7 times. And then they would put their clothes back on. And they would say, because we've sinned on these clothes. So we need to purify ourselves. Number 3. أَنْ يَكُونَ سَبْعَةَ أَشْوَاطٍ كَامِلَةٍ. It has to be 7 complete circumambulation. Fully completing the 7 rounds around the house. You have to complete it. Because the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did what? He did 7. As Umar mentioned, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. What about if you doubt? At 6 or 7, stick to the 6 and do the 7th one again. You're sure that you did 6. You're sure that you did 6. But you're doubtful whether you did the 7. Build the ruling on what you're certain of and avoid what you're doubtful of. You're sure that you did 6? Well, then that's what we're going to base it on. The 4th and 5th is أن يبدأ الطواف من الحجر الأسود وينتهي إليه. You start from the black stone and you finish also at the black stone. Those two. Number 6, أن يكون الطواف خارج البيت. The circumambulation has to be outside the Kaaba. When you say outside the Kaaba, you can't be inside the rock. You can't be, you have to be outside it. You can't be inside the Kaaba. Be outside the Kaaba. Also, what falls under the Kaaba today is Maqamu Ismail, they call it, right? That little part that's round, you see around the Kaaba like that. That part is meant to be part of the Kaaba. That's how big the Kaaba should be normally. Are we all together? So, the Messenger wanted to build it. Are we all together? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Aisha, Lawla, if it wasn't, your people were Hudatha Ahd bil Islam, if your people were not new to Islam, لهدمت الكعبة ولبنيتها على أساس إبراهيم. The Messenger said, Aisha, if the people were not new to Islam, I would have built the Kaaba. I would have demolished this side and then I would have built it big, just the way Ibrahim did it. And the reason why Quraysh, when they were building the Kaaba, they didn't do this part is the nafaqah, it stopped from them. They didn't have the money to carry on. The money that, look, wallahi, subhanallah, kuffar, Quraysh. They were building the Kaaba with what? The money didn't finish from the sense they didn't have money. They did have money. The reason why they didn't complete building that part is because the money finished. But I just said they had money. The money that they had remaining was money that was not halal. And they wanted to build the Kaaba with what? Halal money. Every rock that they put, it has to come from something they're 100% sure was halal. Quraysh, that's what they were doing. And you see a Muslim say, packing his bag and he says, I want to go Hajj with money he knows it's riba. Money that he knows is haram. You want to go to the house of Allah. Quraysh, they were, the kuffar of Quraysh were worried to bring haram into this Kaaba. Are we all together? So they didn't do it. Quraysh didn't do it. The money that they were looking for was halal, couldn't finish off the Kaaba. They couldn't finish off the Kaaba. So then that part, what they did is they made a little mark for it to show that this is still part of the Kaaba. It remained like that until Abdullah ibn Zubayr came and he built it. And then after that, it got destroyed again. I think Hajjaj's time or something, it got destroyed again. It got that part was taken out again. And so no one ever fidgeted with it after that, because everyone comes and he destroys it, and he builds it, and he destroys it, it will take away from the Kaaba what? The hurma that it has. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah fassala fil mas'ala, he spoke about it in great details in his kitab Minhaj Sunnah Nabawiyyah. So, some people, what they do is they go around the Kaaba from inside, from that part. If you do it, that's not tawaf. Tawaf is around the Kaaba. Okay, around the Kaaba. That part, you can't do it. Number 7 is al-muwalatu. It has to be one after the other. It has to be immediately one after the other. Okay? A person can't go and just go home and sleep and come back and then finish off the other 3. Are you with me? You're not allowed to do that. It has to be immediately one after the other. What about if salah comes in? I mean, you have to stop, that's no doubt. But can you carry on? We'll talk about that soon, inshallah ta'ala. And majority of times that might happen to you. One salah you might get caught up with. I want to now mention the shurutu sa'i, the conditions of sa'i, safa wal marwa, conditions. Those are an yakuna sab'at ashwatin. It has to be seven times. You have to do it how many times? It has to be seven times. Number two is beginning with the Safa and ending with Al-Marwa. أَنْ يَبْدَعْ بِالصَّفَى وَيَخْتِمَ بِالْمَرْوَةِ. The person starts with Safa and he finishes with Marwa. The third one is أَنْ يَكُونَ السَّعْيُ فِي الْمَسْعَى وَهُوَ الطَّرِيقُ الْمُمْتَدُّ بَيْنَ الصَّفَى وَالْمَرْوَةِ. The third one is performing along the specified path between Al-Safa and Al-Marwa. It has to be done on that specified road. What about the extended part of the Kaaba where they built it and they extended on it? If we get time in this couple of days, if we get some time, we might discuss the discussion of the scholars of this extra part that was added to it and what they said about it. Even that though, Sheikh Abdul Karim Al-Khudair said, if you were not born before that, you shouldn't talk about it. But we'll just mention what the scholars said, rahimahumullah. Okay, now I'm going to go into actions that are prohibited for the pilgrimage, for the pilgrim. Acts which are prohibited for the pilgrim. Things that he should not do, or things that she should not do. Whatever is specific to the men, we mention it. And whatever is specific to the women, we'll mention it. The men are not allowed to wear the following, and we already spoke about it, right? Lubsul makhiti, some scholar, I told you this. This statement which is wearing sewn clothing, wearing tailored clothing, that statement is not right. Are we all together, brothers? Sewn, lafd al makhit that the fuqaha use. And the first one to use that was Ibrahim al Nakhai, and then from the Hanafiya, I mentioned Zufar ibn Hudayl. Mentioned it after him, in his, and then it was mentioned in Al-Mabsut, the Hanafiya took it and it became common amongst the people. So you see a person who, anything that's stitched, they will unstitch it. Are we all together? That's not the statement. The Hadith, it stated particular things that are, the things that are prohibited are what fits you. That's the correct word, fitting. Whatever fits your body parts, it's fitted around you. That's what's not allowed. Are we all together? And we mentioned the hadith, لا يلبس القمص ولا العمائم ولا السراويلات ولا البرانس ولا الخفافة إلا أحد لا يجد النعلين فليلبس خفين وليقطعهما أسفل من الكعبين ولا تلبس من الثياب شيئا مسه زعفران أو ورس. And we mentioned this, right? The things that you can't wear. You're not allowed to wear what? You're not allowed to wear a qumus. A qumus is a shirt. وَلَا الْعَمَائِمَ. You're not allowed to wear turban on your head. وَلَا السَّرَاوِيلَاتِ. You're not allowed to wear trousers. وَلَا الْبَرَانِسَ. Baranisa is what? It's the thobe with a hoodie. And I told you, it's the one that the Moroccans wear. The Moroccans, you know, see the one they wear? The Maghariba? It's like that one. It looks like that one. وَلَا الْخِفَافَ. Don't wear a khuf. إِلَّا أَحَدٌ لَا يَجِدٌ عَلَيْنِ. Except if you can't find shoes, then wear the khuffain. فليلبس. The Prophet said, let him wear khuffain وليقطعهما أسفل من الكعبين. And then if cut it until it goes under the ankles. And we said this ruling was what? This ruling is abrogated. That last part is abrogated. We mentioned that previously. Naam. The second thing is an issue unique to the woman, which is تغطية وجه المرأة ويديها. تغطية وجه المرأة, the woman placing niqab on her face. ويديها, and her hands. Those two she cannot place, so she can't wear niqab. Because of the hadith of Ibn Umar, لا تنتقب المرأة المحرمة. The woman who's in a state of ihram, she does not wear niqab. ولا تلبس, and she doesn't wear القفازين. The قفازين are the gloves. So some of the scholars, they gave the fatwa that she can wear, she can take a khimar and just throw it on her head. And it just covers her face like that. صح? She can. And it's excessive. Some of them, you see, they're wearing caps. Are you with me? Because they believe nothing can touch their face. We're going to go into all of that, inshallah ta'ala. The only thing that's not allowed is a niqab. Because the hadith stated that. Like, it's allowed for anything other than that to cover herself with. For example, if she takes the edge of her cloth or jilbab or a hijab and she places it over her face like that whenever men go by, as Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said that whenever men, a group of men will go by, غطينا وجوهنا, we will cover our faces. We will cover our faces. So the covering of the face is not prohibited from the woman in Hajj. Okay, that's not prohibited from her. What is prohibited from her is to get something that's covering her face like that. She places a niqab on her face. And she's not also allowed to wear gloves. But that doesn't mean she can bring her hands out. She places her hands in. And the hadith is, I mentioned it for you. Number three is تَغْطِيَةُ الرَّأْسِ الرَّجُلِ بِعَمَامَةِ أَوْ نَحْوِهَا. A man cannot cover his head. You're not allowed to put something on your head. We just mentioned it, the Prophet's statement, what did he say? لَا يَلْبَسُ الْقُمُصَ وَلَا الْعَمَائِمَ. And says, subhanAllah, sometimes you see some people, they take this issue very serious and too much. They go overboard, so they don't go inside cars. They say nothing's allowed to be on top of your head. So they don't go in cars. So if they do go into those cars, the roof is cut off. And I've seen that happen. Or they, you know those golf cars? Those little golf cars. That, have you seen the golf car? Do you guys know the golf cars? You know golf, right? Or you guys only know cricket? You guys know golf, right? Golf, there's little cars that they drive in the garden. So they had some people, they only take those cars. They won't go into the coaches, they won't go into a car, they won't go into anything. And that's incorrect, because the Prophet ﷺ, the hadith that's going to come to us in Jabir, the benefits that we're going to take from it is, أَنَّ النَّبِيَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَمَرَ بِقُبَّةٍ مِنْ شَعَرٍ فَضُرِبَتْ لَهُ بِنَامِرَةٍ فَنَزِلَ بِهَا. The messenger requested for a tent to be made for him in what? Minamira. The tent, what does it do? It covers you. So you can. Okay, number four. At-tibu. Stay away from at-tib. Tib means what? Perfume and anything. You're not allowed to do that. Number five and number six. Is taqlimu al-adhafir wa izalati al-sha'ri bil-halqi aw al-qassi aw ghayri dhalika. Take it from your nails. Or your what? Or your hair. Whether you shorten it or you shave it, you're not allowed to. It's a condition that you can't do that. These are min mahdurat al-ihram. Some people, what they do is they bite their hand. They bite their nails, sorry, not their hands. They bite their nails, right? When they get nervous, you always see them biting their nails. Are you with me? So I saw a brother in Hajj, he had something wrapped around his hand. So I thought he was wounded. I said, what happened to you? He said, yeah, I have to be careful. Of what? Of myself. Well, what are you going to do? He said, whenever I get nervous, I start biting my nails. So I said, Ajib. In Hajj and Umrah, you see everything, just about everything. Any and everything, you come into contact with people. So you can't do that. Also, I saw another extreme group of people. They don't scratch their head. They're like, oh. They don't touch their head. Hey, why don't you scratch your head? Because if I scratch, hair might fall out. I told you guys yesterday, he doesn't touch his beard. If he scratches it in Hajj, he won't scratch his beard. Why? Because if I scratch it, hair falls out. This is halak al-mutanatti'un. This is extreme, brothers. The hadith is talking about intentionally trying to take your hair out. It's intentionally trying to cut your hair. Or it's intentionally trying to take off your nails. Number 8, or number 7, is al-jima'u wa dawa'ihi. Sexual intercourse and anything that might lead to it. You're not allowed to. It's min mahdhurat al-ihram. A man is not allowed to play with his wife in Hajj. You're not allowed to. You're not even allowed to have sexual intercourse. And anything that might lead to sexual issues, you can't. Whether it be talking about it, whether it be playing around, you're not allowed to. Number 8, iqtiraful ma'asi. Stay away from sins. You have to stay away from sins. Number 8 is to stay away from sins. Number 9, al-mukhasamatu wal-jidalu. Stay away from debates and argumentations. Those three that I just mentioned are all mentioned, the last three that I just mentioned. Sexual intercourse and anything that might lead to it. Falling into sins. And argumentation and debates is in the ayah, Al-Hajj ashhurun ma'lumat. Faman farada feehinna al-hajja fala rafatha wala fusuqa wala jidala. Wala jidala fi al-hajj. Fala rafatha, sexual intercourse and whatever might lead to it. Wala fusuqa, ma'asi and sins. Wala jidala, argumentation. Hajj, don't argue. And you see that. You see people arguing in Hajj. Especially Hajj, just about all the groups, they have to sometimes share the same tent. So your hamla, you see different individuals, whether it be this group or that group or this group in the religion, you all are in the same tent. And what happens? May Allah protect. May Allah protect. People who don't even have different aqidahs, but they all have fiqh differences. Books are coming out. Get my bag, it's right there. And the other one gets his bags, and he turns the whole khaymah, and the whole tent turns into a what? Throwing hadiths and books at each other. Stay away from all of that. When you go Hajj, say what you believe. If a person tries to argue with you, just leave them. It's not the place to debate, it's not the place to argue. The same is Ramadan, right? If somebody tries to fight with you or cause you any problems, what do you say to them in Ramadan? You say, Inni mru'u sa'im. I'm fasting, I'll deal with you after Ramadan. Is that what you say? No, you say, I'm fasting. You say, I'm fasting, I don't want to be part of this. The same is Hajj. You do that. Number 10 and 11 is Al-Khitbatu wa Aqdun Nikah. You're not allowed to propose, you can't propose for a girl. You see a father that you've been looking for so long, and Allah has made the opportunity for you to do Hajj with him, and you've been looking to him for him to ask for his daughter, and this is the opportunity of a lifetime where he's relaxed. It's the Kaaba. You think, oh Allah, he can't say no. And so you go into the tent with him and you say, Uncle, I need to talk to you. And you ask for his daughter. No, it's not permissible. Khitbah is not allowed. And if the father, yeah, of course, you want it now? And he sticks his hand out and he calls two witnesses, it's also not allowed. It's called Aqdun Nikah. It's also not allowed. This is based on the hadith that we took previously. لا ينكح المحرم ولا ينكح ولا يخطب. Number 12 is التعرض لسيد البر. The person stays away from hunting. And we said the hunting here is animals on the earth. Okay? You're not allowed to hunt. You're not allowed to hunt. You're not also allowed to convince another person to hunt for you. And if you know somebody hunted for you without you even saying to him, you're also not allowed to take it. Are we all together? You're not allowed to. Because of the ayah, وَحُرِّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ سَيْدُ الْبَرِّ مَا دُمْتُمْ حُرُمًا. And also the hadith that we mentioned, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam rejected the food that was brought to him. Does anyone know what sahabi that was? Huh? Sa'ab ibn Jathamah al-Laythi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And number 13 was what I mentioned, al-aklu mimma sida min ajlihi aw bi isharati ilayhi aw bi i'anatihi. We mentioned that. Now we're going to go into the things that nullify your Hajj. Nullifies it. Khalas. No more Hajj for you anymore. sexual intercourse. The sexual intercourse can happen in two situations. If the person has a sexual intercourse قبل التحلل الأول, after the تحلل الأول. Are you with me, brothers? And this is after the رمي الجمرة العقبة قبل before it's قبل before the رمي of the جمرة العقبة. If that's called, that's before that is التحلل الأول. If before the تحلل الأول he has sexual intercourse, there's no حج. It's null and void. If it's after the تحلل الأول, remember everything is allowed for him. The hadith sunan, hadith Ibn Majah I mentioned. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he say? If you've thrown and you've done your rami, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أحل لكم كل شيء, كل شيء. Everything has been made halal for you, إلا النساء, except the woman. Remember we said that. So if he does sexual intercourse with his wife بعد التحلل الأول, his hajj is not batil, is not null and void, but he's in a serious situation. He has to basically give a sacrifice. Ibn al-Mundhir transmitted an ijma' in that issue. And the second one is tarku ruknu min arkan al-hajj. If a person leaves a pillar from the pillars of hajj, if a person leaves a pillar from the pillars of hajj, and inshallah ta'ala we mentioned some of them, but we're going to go into the discussions regarding it inshallah ta'ala. I just want to mention the blood in hajj are three types. The bloods in hajj are three types. Ad-dima' fil hajj. Write this down because it help us, help you a lot before we go into the hadith of Jabir. It's three. The blood of the tamattu'. The blood of the tamattu'. And the qiran together. The sacrifice related to the tamattu' and the qiran. And that's the hadi that he does. Number two is damul fidya. The second blood is damul fidya, the blood as a ransom. The person is paying this blood for as ransom. And that is the one that we mentioned for the ayah. فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ بِيَأَذًا مِنْ رَأْسِهِ فَفِدْيَةٌ مِنْ صِيَامٍ أَوْ صَدَقَةٍ أَوْ نُسُكٍ. Remember we mentioned that. Who did it come down on? Ka'ab ibn Ujrah. It came down on Ka'ab ibn Ujrah. The third type of blood is called damul jaza. Damul jaza. Damul jaza is هو الدم الذي يجب على المحرم إذا قتل صيدا بريا. It's the blood that is obligatory on the muhrim if he hunts. From where lakin? The earth. But it see no problem, there's nothing upon him. Number four, دم الإحصائي. So what was this, the third blood? The sacrifice as an expiation, right? That was the third, right? And the fourth one is the sacrifice of the one who is not able to complete the rituals of Hajj. It's called Damul Ihsari. The person is unable to finish it. And that's the one ayah Allah mentions it. فَإِنْ أُحْسِرْتُمْ فَمَسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَادِيِ. We'll come into that. The person is not able to complete the rituals of Hajj due to illness or the presence of an enemy or anything of that nature. And Allah said in the ayah, فَإِنْ أُحْسِرْتُمْ فَمَسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِيِ. And if you are prevented from completing them, then sacrifice. The fifth one is damul wat'i. It's the sacrifice that comes from due to sexual intercourse. Those are the five types that the fuqaha mentioned. We'll go into that in more details inshallah ta'ala. I want to now go into the issue of ziyaratul madinatul munawwara and the etiquette regarding that. We already spoke about the virtues of Medina, right? We did. No? Did we? Did we speak about the virtues of Medina? Medina, we mentioned it. And one of the evidences that I spoke about was that the Prophet ﷺ said, Inna al-Madinati kal-kiri. Medina is like a kir. Medina is like a The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, Medina Did we take this hadith in the Bulugh al-Maram? The Prophet ﷺ said, "Inna al-Madinati kal-kiri." Medina is like the bellows. تُخْرِجُ الْخَبَثَ. It gets rid of the filth. لا تقوم الساعة. Medina, it's like a bellows. You know when you blow into the thing and you're cooking the dirt and everything goes out. Medina blows out the filthy people. A filthy person cannot remain in Medina. مُنَافِقًا. Medina will spit that person out. The Prophet said, لا تقوم الساعة. The hour will not strike. حتى تنفي المدينة شرارها. Until Medina gets rid of all of its evil people. كما ينفي الكير خبث الحديد. Just like the bellows, it removes and eradicates and gets rid of the rust on the metal. Also, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم told us, لا تشد الرحال. Do not travel to. إلا إلى ثلاثة مساجد, except three masjids. We're only allowed to travel to what? Three masjids. What are the three masjids that we can travel to? Masjid Nabawi, Masjid Al-Haram, and Masjid Al-Aqsa. Can you travel from here to go to that? What's that grand masjid in Abu Dhabi? Can you travel to go there? No, you can't. You can only travel for what? You can only travel for three masjids. Habibi, coming from another country just to go to that masjid, it goes against this hadith. You're not allowed to. But if you're in Abu Dhabi and you're there, you're local, you're not traveling for it. It's a different thing. Are we all together, brothers? You can only travel for three masjids. Masjid Hada wa Masjid al-Haram wa Masjid al-Aqsa. Good. The etiquette of visiting the Prophet's masjid and the Prophet's grave. We need to mention this. Very important. When you go to Medina, and that's the majority of the people, they start their journey. A lot of the hamalat, sah? They take the people to Medina first, right? They go Medina first and then they go Umrah and then Hajj. So let's study some etiquettes and manners of the ziyarah in Medina. If you come to the masjid, come with your right leg in first. And then say the dua, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Oh Allah, send salutation to Muhammad wa sallim. Allahumma aftah li abwaab rahmatik. Or you can say, A'udhu billahi al-azim. وبوجه الكريم وسلطانه القديم من الشيطان الرجيم. Then you pray 2 rak'ah sunnah in the masjid, tahiyatul masjid, before you sit down. Number 3, stay away from praying the salah إلى جهة القبر قبري. Stay away from praying towards the what? Towards the grave. Some people, they pray towards the grave. And when they get stopped, that's when it is. But they want to pray towards the qabr. Stay away from that. Once the person finishes the salah and they pray, ثُمَّ يَذْهَبُ إِلَى الْقَبْرِ, go to the grave. Are you allowed to travel from England or Dubai or any other country in the world? Your intent is to go to the Prophet's grave. Are you allowed to do that? No. You're not allowed to travel for the Prophet's grave. You travel for the masjid, and once you come to the masjid, you visit the Prophet's grave. There's a difference between ziyara to qabri Rasulullah, visiting the Prophet's grave, this is permissible, without a doubt. Visiting the grave. Are we all together? Lakin, to travel for the Prophet's grave is a different discussion. That's not permissible. We mentioned the hadith right now. What did we say? La tashuddu rihala. Do not travel. Don't cut a distance for only these three places. Nowhere else. Are you with me, brothers? But what about if I want to go to a halaqa and a sheikh has a dars and I want to go there and I want to benefit? Is that allowed? How do you go outside the discussion here? Can you go? Can I travel from one country to another country to go to that halaqa and to benefit? Hey, why, Shahid? Okay. But how do you reconcile this with this hadith? Yeah. No. That's not the one. Huh? Huh. That's all good, but how do you reconcile between these two? Brothers, you're not traveling to a place, you're traveling to a concept. You're not traveling to a land, you're not going to the masjid. You're not traveling to a masjid. We're talking about traveling to a place, you're not allowed to other than these three places. Are you with me, brothers? But you can travel for business if you want to, and worldly issues. Like when it comes to traveling for a particular place, you're not allowed to other than these three places. Like you can travel for seeking knowledge. Seeking knowledge is not a place. Are we all together, brothers? So the Prophet's grave is a place. You're not allowed to travel for that. But once you go, and you go to the Prophet's masjid, it's very disrespectful that you don't visit the grave. You go and visit him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You give him salams. And you stay away from placing your hand on your chest. Some people, they do this. Actually, to be honest, a lot of us actually do it when we give salams to someone. We say that, right? Well, I mean, I'm from them, sometimes I do it. I see someone. What I'm trying to say is your ibaha. It's good to avoid that. Mm-hmm. Stay away from it. So give the Prophet salam. And the person says, As-salamu ala ahli diyari min al-mu'mineen wal-muslimeen. When they go to Baqi'. After you go to the Prophet's grave, and you give salam to the Prophet, we'll talk about that in more details, what you do and how you say it. I don't want to mention it now. And then you go to Baqi' and you make dua for the people of Baqi'. What do you do? You make dua for the people of Baqi'. The fifth thing that you need to do is, don't raise your voice in the Prophet's masjid. This is the Prophet's masjid, don't raise your voice. Or even next to the grave. Let your voice be very low. Have good manners with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His masjid. Umar radiallahu anhu saw two men shouting. And so Umar took a pebble from somewhere and he threw it at them to get their attention. And so they looked at him. And then he said, Aina antuma, where are you guys from? They said, we're from Taif. Umar said, if you guys were from Medina, لَأَوْجَعْتُكُمَا وَجَعَ, I would have beaten you guys severely. I would have lashed you guys severely if you guys were from the people of Medina. Why? Because they were raising their voices in the Prophet's masjid. So you're not allowed to raise your voice. Number six is وَلْيَحْرِسْ عَلَى الصَّلَاةِ فِي جَمَاعَةِ فِي الصُّفُوفِ الْأُولَى لِمَا فِي ذَلِكَ مِنَ الْفَضْلِ الْجَمِّ وَالثَّوَابِ الْعَظِيمِ. The person should try hard to pray all of the salah in where? The person should try hard to pray all of those salah in the front row. It's sad that somebody will travel from a distance, come from another country, and he spends all his time away from the, he's in the hotel, he's in the mall, in Medina, he's in the mall, going around, buying things, and you've come from a different country. You don't have this luxury of staying here. So what you do is, you stay in the masjid as much as you can, and you do adhkar from one salah to the other and you pray at the front row. Number 7, don't let your striving to pray in the rawdah prevent you from praying at the front row, because the front row is better than anything else because of the general rulings that have come regarding it. After that, go and pray in the rawdah if you want. وليس من السنة أن is not also from the sunnah أن يحرص على الصلاة في المسجد 40 صلاة متوالية بناء على الحديث الذي اشتهر على ألسنة الناس تداوله. And also there's a hadith that's famous on the people's tongue that you have to try 40 hadith, 40 salahs, you have to pray with the people in the jama'ah. The hadith where they say that the Prophet said, من صلى في مسجد 40 صلاة لا يفوت صلاة ما كتبت له براءة من النار ونجا من العذاب وبرئ من النفاق. If anybody prays 40 salahs in my masjid and he doesn't miss any of them, it will be written for him that Allah will save him from the fire, and Allah will protect him from the punishment of the hellfire, and Allah will free him from being from the hypocrites. That hadith is ضعيف لا يصح, it's weak and it's not authentic. Okay, but that doesn't mean you don't try hard. Why are you restricting yourself to 40? Make it 100. Do more. But to think that there's a specific reward for 40, I've seen a brother who prayed only 40 and then he goes, Alhamdulillah, now I can relax. What are you going to do? Yeah, I'm just going to now pray in my local masjid. And are you with me? No, why didn't you carry on? Number 9, it is not legislated and yukthir at-taraddud ala al-qabr sharif al-salam ala al-rasul. It's not from the sunnah to every time you go to the masjid, you go to the grave. You go to the masjid, you go to the grave. Every time. Because you say, I want to give him salams. فَالسَّلَامُ يُبَلِّغُهُ. The salam, it reaches him حَيْثُ مَا كَانَ, wherever you are. It will reach him. There are angels that are going to take it to him. And number 10 is, وَإِذَا خَرَجَ مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ. When you're leaving the masjid, لَا يَمْشِي الْقَهْقَرَى. When you're leaving the masjid and you're exiting the masjid, don't walk backwards. Don't go backwards. And the reason why I mention this is because there are some people when they leave the masjid, they leave backwards. You know why? Because they say, I don't want to turn my back on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Are you with me? All of this is not from the evidences. The person should also try to go to Masjid Quba if he's in Medina. It's a sunnah to go to that place. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go there. Sometimes he would take a riding beast, sometimes he would walk towards it. And he will pray 2 rak'ah. The Messenger said in the hadith, "Man tatahara fi bayti," anyone who purifies himself in his house. ثم أتى مسجد قباء, and he comes to the Masjid Quba. فصلى فيه, and he prays inside it. كان له كأجر عمرة, he gets the reward of Umrah. Also, it's good to go to Baqi'. Baqi' is a grave of the Muslims that are buried there. Many of the Sahabas are buried there. It is recommended to go there. Also, some of the scholars, they mentioned it's good to go to Uhud and visit it, because the Prophet said, Uhudun jabalun yuhibbuna wa nuhibbuh. Uhud is a mountain that loves us and we love it. And there are 70 of the Prophet's companions that are buried there, that battle that took place. Last 2 points that I want to mention before the salah is, number 1 is أن يحرس كثير من الحجاج على المكث في المدينة المنورة أيام أكثر من الأيام التي يمكثونها في مكة. Many people, they stay in Medina more than they stay in Mecca, and that's not what you should do. The salah in the Prophet's masjid is only 1,000, and the salah in what, Mecca, is how many? 100,000. So you should spend more time in where? In Mecca. Number 2, كثير من الحجاج, many of the حجاج, they think the visiting of the Prophet's masjid is from the manasik of Hajj. They think it's part of the Hajj ritual to go and visit the Prophet's masjid. So they if they don't go, or if the package doesn't take them, they think, they cause a big fuss that the Hajj is not worked out and I didn't do Hajj. And they base it on the false hadith, the fabricated hadith, the made up hadith. Fabricated, it's the worst form of hadith. that they say, man hajja, anyone who does hajj, falam yazurni, and he hasn't come to visit me, faqad jafani, he has boycotted me. So they hold on to that false made up hadith, which is not true. But it's good for the person to go. It's not from the rituals. Now let's go into the wording of the hadith. Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ حَجَّ فَخَرَجْنَا مَعَهُ. So the narration here, it starts by saying that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was doing Hajj. But before that, because Hafidh ibn Hajar in Bulugh al-Maram, he took out some wordings of Imam Muslim. And there's a reason why he did that, because he wants to make it very short. Let's mention the before that. Before that, it says, "Inna Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam makkatha tis'a sinin lam yahujj." 9 years, the Messenger didn't do Hajj. In Medina, he was there for 9 years, and he didn't do Hajj. So, but the Prophet did Hajj before Islam. In the Meccan days, before Medina, the Messenger did Hajj in Mecca, as Ibn Hajar mentioned. Lakin as he came to Medina, he never done no Hajj. This is the first time he's going to do Hajj. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the day that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left Mecca, sorry, Medina, was on a Saturday. لِخَمْسٍ بَقِينَ مِنْ ذِي الْقِعْدَةِ 5 days was remaining from ذِي الْقِعْدَةِ 5 days was remaining from ذِي الْقِعْدَةِ. The Prophet left on a Saturday. And the year was the 10th year. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he spent on the road for the eight nights. It took him how long? 8 nights sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Jabir then said, "Fakharajna ma'ahu." We went out with the Messenger. We came out with him. This shows you that when it got announced that the Messenger is going out to do Hajj this year, every single body wanted to do it with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Everyone wanted to do it with him. And the number of people that did Hajj with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 120,000. 120,000. And this shows us how the Sahabas were striving to be there and to do Hajj with the Prophet. And what we benefit from this is the virtue of being in the company of righteous people. And if they're doing khair, to indulge and do the khair with them. And if you know you're going to benefit from that person, akhlaq, ilm, then you do it. So the Prophet ﷺ went and he reached Dhul Hulayfa, the miqat of the people of Medina. When the Messenger came to the miqat of the people of Medina, حتى أتينا ذا الحليفة. Jabir said, we came to the Hulayfa. فولدت أسماء بنت عميسن. أسماء بنت عميسن gave birth. Who knows who أسماء بنت عميسن is? Put your hand up if you know who she is. Huh? Who is she? She was the wife of Ja'far. Okay, any other opinion? The wife of Abu Bakr. Any other opinion, hey? Asma bint Umays, who is she? After Ja'far, she married Abu Bakr. That's correct. Both. Ja'far used to be married to her. When Ja'far died, Abu Bakr married her. Who's the child which she gave birth to? Whose child was it? Yeah? Whose child is it? Yeah? Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr is Ja'far's son. It's Abu Bakr's son. She gave birth to Abu Bakr's son. What's amazing with the hadith is Asma doesn't get mentioned after this at all. I've always wondered why? Because the important thing that we want to know is she's in her postnatal bleeding. So if she's in her postnatal bleeding, not in any of the tariq of the hadith is mentioned. All day today I was looking for all the turuq. And I've seen other scholars negate it. Her mention, it stops here. So the question is, did she remain on her menses when she reached Medina? And so she could do everything fine? Meaning, before the Prophet could come back from Medina, Makkah, from Medina after Hajj, did things finish for her, or did it carry on? And if it did carry on, did the Messenger allow her to do tawaf around the Kaaba from the angle of darura, necessity? None of that is stated. None of that is stated. Qadarullah ma sha'a fa'al. Anyways, the Prophet ﷺ said to Asma, because she wanted to know, Asma bint Umaysin wanted to know, what can she do? فَقَالَ the Prophet said to her, اغْتَسِلِي, clean yourself completely. وَاسْتَثْفِرِي. What does it mean, وَاسْتَثْفِرِي? Istithfar means tie a thing in your waist and then let two sides of it dangle, puts a cloth there to protect that which is coming from you and tie it to your waist. It's what we would say today, the underwear that women wear, with a cloth being put there, an extra cloth, just so that nothing comes out or nothing comes down. That's what the Prophet commanded her to do that. Thumma, after that, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he prayed the salah in the masjid. Here the question here is, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he prayed. This salah that he prayed, it was dhuhr, as in riwayat mentioned. The person, is he allowed to pray sunnah? No doubt it's best to pray an actual wajib salah. But is it permissible to pray a sunnah? And is it good? There's a khilaf amongst the scholars, and that which seems the correct is that it's permissible. But it's good to make sure or try to wait for obligatory prayer so you can follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. ثم ركب, then the Messenger, he mounted on al-qaswa'a. Qaswa'a was the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam's camel. That was the name that was given to qaswa'a. The word qaswa means an-naqa allati quti'at udhunuh. Qaswa is the camel which its ears cut. It's got a cut ear, slit. Like in the Prophet ﷺ, his naqa's ear was not cut. No sign was on there. Nothing like that was done. But he liked to call the camel qaswa because he really loved qaswa. He really loved this camel, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, alayhi salatu wa sallam, hatta idha stawat bihi ala al-bayda'a. Here the question is, we mentioned last time, when did the Prophet then do the tahleel? When did he proclaim? When did he say it loudly? We said the masjid, right? And we spoke about it when it came to the issue of al-bayda'a, the open land, Abdullah ibn Umar in rejecting that. We mentioned that, right? So how do we reconcile between those two narrations? Both parties are right. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one group, they heard him say it in the masjid, and some heard it when he mounted on his camel, and some heard it when he was out in the open. Each place he was saying the tahleel loud. That's when they heard it, is when they mentioned it. The Messenger said, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ لَبَّيْكَ لَبَّيْكَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَكَ لَبَّيْكَ إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ وَالنِّعْمَةَ لَكَ وَالْمُلْكَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَكَ. What does it mean, labbaik Allahumma labbaik? It means ijabata laka ba'da ijaba. Oh Allah, we're obeying you, and again we're obeying you. The question here is that you only obey or you accept the call when there was a call done, right? So someone has to call you in order for you to say ay labbaika. Labbaika, the Arabs bi ijma'i ahli al-lugha, by the consensus of the people of the language, the labbaik is only used when somebody calls you. So where were these? The Prophet called and his companions. وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا وَعَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ يَأْتِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍّ عَمِيقٍ. Surah Al-Hajj, Ayah 20, Ayah 27. Surah Al-Hajj, Ayah 27. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala said, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ, proclaim to the people. So the Hajj was proclaimed, salawatullahi wa salam alayhi, to him and his companions. So that's what he means. Oh Allah, we're obeying your call. We're obeying your command. لَبَّيْكَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَكَ. This one is takrar للتأكيد. The Prophet is repeating it again to emphasize on it. إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ. We can say إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ, or we can say أَنَّ الْحَمْدَ. Both we can say it. We can say إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ, and we can say أَنَّ الْحَمْدَ. If we say إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ, then it becomes جُمْلَ مُسْتَأْنَفَ, a complete sentence that stands by itself. Which means, when we say إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ, it means, oh Allah, all praise is to you in any situation. But when we say أَنَّ الْحَمْدَ, it's لِلْتَعْلِيلِ, reasoning. Oh Allah, praise is to you because. When we say أَنَّ الْحَمْدَ, that's what it means. Oh Allah, we obey you because you are praiseworthy and you have bestowed upon us these blessings. The word Alhamdu means what? It means Al-Wasfu bil-Kamali ma'al-Mahabbati wa-Ta'zim. It is to describe Allah in completeness, that He's complete, subhanahu wa ta'ala, with love and veneration, love and glorification. Wa-Ni'mah, Ni'mah means what? Al-Fadl, virtue. That you bestowed upon us virtue. Laka. The lam in laka is lamul ikhtisas. It's only for you, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wal mulk, kingdom, is for you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're the king of all of the creation. You're the one who controls everything. La sharika lak. You have no partners in any of that. You're alone in that. Because the ayah says, وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ, right? There is no blessing that comes to you. It's only from who? So the ni'mah is only from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he stuck to the talbiyah. Alayhi salatu wa sallam, he stuck to his talbiyah, as it says in the other wording, وَلَزِمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talbiyatahu. And it's good to stick to the talbiyah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what he said, and not to add to it. But there were other people that were saying other things that the Prophet wasn't saying. There were other people saying other things that the Prophet wasn't saying. Or they were increasing on that which the Prophet didn't say. They were saying extra things. There were people who were doing that. It doesn't matter, whichever people you hear saying something else, it's not a problem. Let them say what they want, because the Prophet ﷺ didn't say anything to them. حَتَّى إِذَا أَتَيْنَا الْبَيْتَ. So the Messenger then, he said his talbiyah, and he's on his riding beast, until he came to the Kaaba. حَتَّى إِذَا أَتَيْنَا, until we came to الْبَيْتَ, we came to the Kaaba. إِسْتَلَمَ الرُّكْنَ, the Prophet ﷺ, what did he do? He touched the, Kaaba. I wanna mention some points, inshallah ta'ala. There are one. When it comes to touching the black stone, there are four situations. Touching the black stones is four situations. One is that you touch it and you kiss it. And the touching is with the right hand, because the right hand is what? It's to show veneration and respect. Your right hand is good. The left hand is not that good hand. And the second one is, if he's unable to touch it, and he's unable to kiss it, what does he do? So he can't kiss it, sorry, he only touches it. So the second situation is that only touches it. He can't kiss, for whatever reason. The second situation is to only touch it. The third situation is, he can't touch the Kaaba with his hand. The third situation is he uses a stick or something, an object, and he touches it with that object, like the Messenger did, alayhi salatu wasalam. The Prophet used his stick. And the fourth one is, he can't do any of that, he uses his hand, that's it. And he only uses one hand. Why? What's the wisdom of touching the stone? It's to honor Allah, not the stone, honor Allah. And it's to honor the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to follow the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But it doesn't mean that this stone can do something, it can harm us, or it can affect us, or it can, no. It's Allah azza wa jalla we're doing it for. He's the one who commanded us to do it. What does the person say when they touch a black stone? What do they say? The sunnah is to say Allahu Akbar. We mentioned that, right? But there's also that which is transmitted from Abdullah ibn Umar, that he used to say Bismillah. He used to say Bismillah Wallahu Akbar. Bayhaqi narrated it bi isnadin sahih. And Abdullah ibn Umar was very well known for following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam so much. So the scholars, some of them, they said mawqufu lafdan marfu'u hukma. It's even that though it's Ibn Umar who is doing it, but it's attributed to who? But it's attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the person says Bismillah Wallahu Akbar. Like in Wallahu Akbar, there's evidence for that. The Prophet did that sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That the Prophet did that. طاف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم على بعير كلما أتى على الركن أشار إليه بشيء في يده وكبر. That's the Prophet. Okay, another thing I want to mention is there a virtue in touching the black stone? If I touch it, what virtue do I get? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he mentioned the hadith Imam Muhammad narrated in his Sunnah Musnad min hadith Ibn Umar. The Prophet said inna mashal hajari, the touching of the stone, the black stone, والركن اليماني, and touching the corner, the Yemeni corner, يحطان الخطايا, they remove the sins from you, they remove it from you. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in another hadith Imam Tirmidhi narrated min hadith Ibn Abbas, وإنه ليبعثه الله تعالى يوم القيامة, Allah will bring the black stone the day of judgment. له عينان, has two eyes, and it will have a tongue in which it will talk. On what? يَشْهَدُ عَلَى مَنْ إِسْتَلَمَهُ بِحَقِّ, and it will testify for the person who touched it with truth. The one who, when he was touching it, he was sincere, he was real. ولذلك, some of the scholars, they said the ayah وَالسَّمَاءِ ذَاتِ الْبُرُوجِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْمَوْعُودِ وَشَاهِدٍ وَمَشْهُودٍ. Some of the scholars, they said that the shahid and the mashhood here, that's going to testify for you the day of judgment. Some of the scholars, they said it's Hajar al-Aswad. There's many aqwal, but some of the scholars, they mentioned that the Hajar al-Aswad is being referred to here. What about if it's not Hajj or Umrah? It's not Hajj or Umrah. I'm doing Tawaf around the Kaaba. I ain't doing Hajj. I ain't doing Umrah. Is it good to touch the Kaaba? Is it good to touch it? Jumhur al-Ulama are of the opinion, no. Jumhur al-Ulama are of the opinion, no. If it's not Hajj, and if it's not Umrah that you're doing around the Kaaba, no. That's the overwhelming majority of the scholars, what they believe. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he touched the stone. He touched it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَرَمَلَ ثَلَاثًا وَمَشَى أَرْبَعًا. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he jogged for how many? The first three he jogged, and the fourth one, and the fifth, and the sixth, and the seventh, the next four, he walked, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He walked, alayhi salatu wa sallam. The scholars, they mention a reason why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam jogged. There was a hikmah why he jogged. They said, Ibn Abbas narrated Bukhari and Muslim, لَمَّا قَدِمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَأَصْحَابُهُ مَكَّةِ. When the messenger came to Mecca, and his companions, they came to Mecca, فَقَالَ الْمُشْرِكُونَ, the pagans, they said, إِنَّوْ يَقْدُمُ عَلَيْكُمْ قَوْمٌ وَهَنَتْهُمْ حُمَنْ. There's going to come to you a group of people who the mosquitoes of Medina have gone into their bodies, and they're suffering from a malaria. They're sick people, weak. Weak people are going to come to you. Muhammad and his companions are going to come to you guys. إِنَّهُمْ يَقْدُمُ عَلَيْكُمْ قَوْمٌ وَهَنَتْهُمْ حُمَى يَثْرِبَ. Yathrib, Yemen, Medina, its mosquitoes have harmed them. So the Prophet knew that, right? فَأَمَرَهُمُ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَنْ يَرْمَلُوا عَلَى الْأَشْوَاطَ الثَّلَاثَةَ, to show them, we ain't sick, we're strong. The Prophet ran for three. Remember, this is hot, no air conditioner, no marble, none of that. So he went around the Kaaba three times. And the fourth and the fifth and the sixth and seventh, for his companions, the Prophet ﷺ took that away. Question. If that's the reason why the Prophet do it, why are we doing it for today? That was the illah, right? That was a reason. Now the illah is removed. Huh? Yeah, but he did it for a reason. الحكم يدور مع علته وجودا وعدما. The ruling revolves around its reason. If the reason is found, the ruling is found. If the reason is missing, the ruling is missing. Why do you stay away from drinking alcohol? Because it intoxicates. What about if it doesn't intoxicate? You can drink it. صح. The ruling revolves around the reason, illa, why something was made permissible, or why it was made halal, or why it was made haram. The reason why the raml was made was for these kuffar. That reason is gone. Does the ruling go with it? It's not a rhetorical question, it's a direct question. I want an answer. Yeah? Muhammad again. Sahih, Jameel. The Sahaba, Umar radiallahu anhu, and other companions, they would jog and they said, we will not stop this. We will not stop doing this. And even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's companions, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he took over Mecca and the kuffar were weak. So even what they said to themselves would have been with them. So this ruling, ala kulli hal, is something that carries on, that we will do forever. Like, remember I mentioned a point where you show your arm, your right arm, and you what? Well, this is done for how long? This is only done when you come into the Kaaba. Some people do it from the Miqat. From Dil Hulayfa in the coach, they have one arm showing. No, you don't. You only do that when you see the Kaaba. The minute you see it, you open it. Some scholars, they say, no. You actually only do it when you come to the Hajar al-Aswad. When you start, then you show your arm. Ala kulli hal, you only do it at that moment. The first three you show, and then after that you don't show. It's not all the time that you show.